A very warm welcome to this very special gathering that has been organized by Money Control Commodity Ki Paathshala. This is presented by NCDEX IPF Trust in association with Solvent Extractor Association. Well, we are going to talk 360 degrees about the edible oil space today, and there is so much that has happened in the last 6 months. First, it was the COVID impact, where you saw the out-of-house consumption completely decline, but the in-house consumption actually continued to gain on. In the last 6 months, we also have seen the prices gain up quite strongly. The crude palm oil prices were running because there was decline in palm oil production in Malaysia. We saw steady moves upside for soybean as well. And then mustard has continued to hit all-time highs. There has been some profit taking since then, and the markets really are looking at various fundamentals. It has to do with imports, which have been costly. The demand is picking up as the lockdown is easing. We also have seen the weather impact coming for commodities, especially the edible oil prices. Edible oil as a sector is given to a lot of fundamentals because it's not just domestic, but the international cues as well continue to hamper it a lot. China, US, you name it, and almost everything impacts the edible oil sector. So we will get an understanding on where the price stands right now and what is the scenario going forward for 2020-21 as well. Joining us is a very esteemed panel. I am joined by Mr. Atul Chaturvedi, who is President, Solvent Extractor Association. We also have with us Mr. Vipin Gupta, who is CEO, Louis Dreyfus, at the company. Vijay Kumar is MD and CEO at NCDEX. And we also have Nirav Desai, who is MD, Nickel Commodity and Derivatives Private Limited. Gentlemen, hi. Thank you so much for taking your time out for us today. Mr. Chaturvedi, let's start with you first. And what is the industry looking like right now? What is the scenario that's playing out? Would you continue to watch out for the international scenarios, or is it going to be about the government reforms, the demand that is finally opening up?
Manisha, you very rightly put that edible oil has to necessarily look at various factors. First, we were looking at who comes in the White House. Now that Biden seems to be there, but Mr. Trump doesn't seem to be leaving. So there's a little bit of a question mark there. How things will pan out as far as Chinese demand is concerned, that doesn't seem to be relenting. But what we are seeing with Biden coming to power in US, Chinese demand seems to be now plateauing a bit, and the Chinese are probably profit-taking. So last couple of days, we are seeing Chinese values coming off a bit. Coming to India, we were anticipating very good Diwali demand. Diwali demand has been, I won't say lackluster, but not like the way it used to be in the past. The demand in India is definitely contracting, whatever people may say, and this is reflecting in our imports as well. In fact, this year India would end up importing something like less than 2 million tons compared to what we imported last year. And the major issue is that palm oil is getting affected as far as India is concerned. So Indian demand going forward with high prices is also likely to suffer. And we should not be too surprised if next year we have lower imports, even compared to what we've got this year. And on top of this, next year we are also looking at a much better mustard crop, even though the numbers which we've seen lately of the sowing doesn't instill too much confidence. But I was talking to my colleagues in the panel. They feel that the sowing actually started a bit late, and now it's going to pick up as we get to see the other the weekly reports. Government is quite gung-ho on mustard improving big time this year. In fact, the government numbers last year was about, I think, they were talking of 9.3 million tons. And this year, the government is actually targeting 12.5 million tons of mustard production. If that happens, that would actually put almost more than a million tons of oil, domestic oil, into the system. And all these things put together should possibly put some sense in the runaway prices which we've seen in the last couple of months. So probably at this level, there will be a little bit of a wait and watch and maybe a marginal profit taking, which might come off, make the markets come off. But overall, we feel that the markets would remain relatively friendly. Over to you.
By friendly, I'm assuming you're saying firm, but not so high, because we already have seen some profit taking, especially in mustard, as you said, because it was record highs for many, many days. And now it's finally come off. And as you said, that's because of the sowing numbers that we are looking at right now. So Nirav, let me make a bit of a weatherman out of you, because we've spoken about this on air sometimes. We've seen the recent rains, damaging the crops. Groundnut in Gujarat, soybean in MP and Maharashtra, sunflower in Karnataka. What are you looking at as the final numbers here? Because this has been one of the reasons that we saw the prices run up.
Yeah. So finally, when we talk about the domestic crops, definitely the rains did impact quite a bit. The crops were faring out well. They were prospering well in both groundnut and soybeans. But the expectation was quite a higher crop, say about 20-25% higher crop in both the crops. But eventually in soybeans, around 5-7% higher than last year is what we are seeing. And even in groundnut, we are not seeing a big jump. And on the contrary, on groundnut, like, there was a lot of export commitment to China for groundnut oil. And there was a lot of short covering which rallied the oil. Similarly, on soybeans, people were expecting quite a bit of big crop coming in. There were some small export commitments, but still, I think even after that, there was a big rally on the crop itself. We saw about 400 to 450 rupees soybeans rallying from their bottom. So I think weather did play bad here. And if we talk about crops worldwide also, I think this year has proved out to be a big weather disaster everywhere. In Ukraine and Russia, we see around 2.5 million tons of sun oil loss. We see the US crop also eventually faring out lower than expected. South American crop is under concern because of the La Nina. And as far as palm goes, I think we are at one of the lowest levels of palm stocks in the month of October or November. This is the time when we used to see end stock of minimum 1.8, 1.9 million tons, and we have seen as high as 2.8, 2.7 million tons also. Compared to that, we have a much lower stock. So I think weather has played everywhere, whereas demand definitely for at least a quarter or two quarters due to COVID was impacted in all countries. So that is the situation here.
Vipin, I want to come to you now. And while, of course, we've discussed with our earlier panelists on how the prices have been volatile, weather played a bit of a havoc, and then COVID did, and the impact, of course, has been seen in the domestic markets and international as well. Well, of course, I'll keep going back to them to understand this deeper. But when we look at this kind of volatility, where you are looking at the crop, the price moves, as a company as yours, which has exposure across, how has hedging helped you? How would you recommend doing that? And how have you yourself made use of it?
Thanks, Manisha. I think for all the people who don't believe in hedging, this is the perfect year when you understand why you need to hedge. Ever since we joined this industry, we have been reading about one black swan event for which you should hedge. So for us, hedging is not for your day-to-day volatility. Most of the time, what you hedge is you hedge yourself against the black swan events and nothing more than COVID, which sort of gives you an idea why hedging is important. We saw the market coming, if right up about BMB, coming from all the way to about 33,000, 3,100 to 2,200 on lack of demand, demand even on the biofuel sector, and then rallying back because of tight production currently. To again, let's say, if we talk about third month, 3250, nobody could have predicted the way it has moved around. And factors are too many, be it COVID, be it currency fluctuations, be it demand destruction, biofuel, petroleum. So there are too many factors affecting for you to take an educated guess and say, you want to be long or short. And last week we saw NCDX contract hitting 1,000 rupees for the first time. And if you look at the contract within the life of the contract, it has moved very close to 50%. And most of the commodity companies, if you analyze the annual results, your results are plus or plus 2% at best. If you're lucky, 3% is considered to be excellent result. And you're looking at a volatility of 50%. So to me, it's not an option to hedge yourself. You need to hedge to ensure continuity. It's not about what kind of P&L you make. I think it's more about survival. And in these years, I think we are going one step forward and looking at our suppliers and our buyers to look at their hedging. What are they hedging or not? Because if they're not hedging, then I'm taking a bigger exposure dealing with them. So I think all of us need to go one step extra to see whether our suppliers or our consumers are hedging and encourage them to hedge. And it's not only for a company like us. I think it's for all the listed company, for all the banks, those who have exposure in these companies. It's a serious amount of money that they are exposed to. So I think hedging is a must. I don't think it's an option.
Vipin, since you follow the oilseed segment so closely, what really has been your experience on how the segment really behaves? You know, the last few years, it has been a steady one. We know what our demand is. We know the crop cycle. We also know what kind of supplies we are getting, what countries to follow, etc. But would you say that this year really has been quite different, out of the whack, etc.? And how would you look at the years gone by and how would you compare this one?
I think whatever I've seen in my last 24 years, I've seen more than that in this 1 year. Starting with demand restriction because of COVID, then bouncing back. And in terms of weather, I think God had been too kind for last 5, 6, 7 years. It was a benign weather through the globe. And when it hit back hard. So you had weather issues in Europe. Now you have weather issues in North America and potential issues in South America. So I think... weather issues are coming with vengeance, and I think last we saw this kind of situation was 2012-13, so almost 7 years of benign weather throughout the globe. So I think by law of averages, it was just waiting to catch up.
You know,
but again, I would not like to advise to go long or anything. We still believe in hedging, so yeah.
No, I totally get that. You know, I remember, because this is the first virtual one I'm doing for edible oils, but we've met on ground, all of us, and in one of those seminars, I remember Mr. Chaturvedi saying on stage that oil seeds pe to government ka dhyan hi nahi hai, because yahan pe sab theek hai, the prices are not running too high, too low, so when you are not in, when you don't catch attention, you don't, see severe steps as well coming in. So Atulji, has much changed since then?
You can see the noises now in government circles and in opposition parties.
It's exactly what I'm asking you.
No, in fact, possibly for the first time now, there is some thinking in the government that it is important to get moving on the Atmanirbharta. But the kind of action which we are seeing on the ground is not actually instilling any confidence. In fact, we've been telling the government you need to earmark almost something like 4,000 to 5,000 crore rupees. When the edible oil prices were pretty low, we said this is the best time to put some cess and transfer that money into the oilseed development fund. But in India, decisions take their own sweet time. But having said that, the high prices are actually a blessing in disguise for India and for the Indian oilseed farmer. So I possibly feel that the Indian farmer is much more intelligent than what we think he is. And his response to prices is phenomenal. So I would not be too surprised if this time you have something like 20-25% more of mustard being sown. And that should possibly, going forward, help a lot as far as India is concerned, because then your domestic oil availability would improve by almost 1 million, 1.5 million. And that's a big number.
So what you are saying is that there is some action and reaction finally that we are seeing in this sector, because one is we import a lot, and yes, the policies not just here but outside the country as well tend to impact us. Let me come to you now, Mr. Avikumar. And we've seen a lot of moves when it comes to the trading on the exchange itself. How would you, Mr. Vijay Kumar, I'm sorry, how would you look at the latest reforms that have come in from SEBI, especially when it comes to farmers, as it comes to FPOs as well. You made a decision, you made some announcements yesterday as well. What has been the feedback? How are you encouraging the FPOs and what are you expecting going forward?
Yeah, I think I'd like to certainly take off from where Mr. Chaturvedi and Vipin have sort of articulated that risk management is not a choice. You have to do it if you want to survive in a volatile world. And there's always a surprise around the corner. So I think one of the things that we are with very significant support from SEBI are doing is to get farmers also to understand that this is a good thing. So for instance, as was pointed out, soybean is at a record high, and yet we see a lot of farmers and FPOs not utilizing prices. It's almost like at 3900 you think it's going to go down because of harvest, and it goes up, and now that it's been up for a consistent amount of time, possibly people are assuming it's going to go up or not. And since there's so much uncertainty, the right thing for the farmer or the through the farmer producer organization is to lock it in. Start locking in prices, not only for soybean as it stands currently, because it's giving you a very good return on your planted seed, but on, for example, mustard as you're planting now for the rabi crop. And as Mr. Chaturvedi said, there is going to be farmers wanting to plant more, but as they plant, it's good to lock in prices. So we are really encouraging both processors on the one side for the new crop to give those price signals, and for farmers and farmer producer organizations who are responding to those price signals by actually taking decisions of planting seed in the ground, not to then leave it open to risk, but to lock it in. And of course, prices will go up or go down as we move ahead in the season. But as long as people are locking in their margins, whether it is processors locking in the margins in the early part of the season, we've seen good margins. So as long as people lock in margins, I think everyone can be happy. The Atmanirbhar long-term approach is processors making money, farmers growing more and yet making good incomes because of this timely locking in of prices, I think, or margins, as I would put it. So in a way, it's good. I think we are seeing, at least in this oilseed sector, the burden is not on the government to come and buy large quantities as it is in grains, wheat and paddy especially. At least here, the industry is supporting farmers. The country requires the oil. So it's really good to see the synergy between industry, trade houses, and research organizations, brokers. But we are, for the moment, putting a lot of emphasis on farmers and FPOs for achieving this purpose.
You spoke about the whole value chain, Mr. Vijay Kumar, but I also want you to spend a moment telling us on the new initiative on the FPO's announcement that you made yesterday, and how will that get this stakeholder onto the exchange, onto the platform, and enable them to make use of this?
Yeah, sure. As we all know that farmers and FPOs have used futures in the past, but one of the things with futures is that if they lock in a price, they don't benefit from any upside move that can happen. And therefore, the options is a better instrument for them. And so what we've done as an initiative backed by SEBI is to start familiarizing FPOs through doing, not just by talking, but to initiate them into buying a put option, for example, for mustard. And with that put option, they have basically locked in say a price of 5,100, and therefore they have locked in their income. Now, this obviously involves a premium. So the premium, for instance, in this case is around maybe 250, 300 rupees. So that premium is to some extent supported by a fund which was created by SEBI or set aside by SEBI as a part from the regulatory fee that exchanges pay to SEBI, saying that use this money for familiarizing farmers and FPOs for utilizing the markets for their risk management. So I think while this is certainly a good start. We are finding that FPOs are really wanting this instrument, but they maybe don't have the funds to buy it. But this will, I think, once this happens and once people see that this has helped them lock in their prices, and if prices go down, they will really then put in their own money or be supported by other entities like banks and government and industry as well, the seed industry, for instance, to help the farmers use this as much as they use seed, fertilizer, pesticide, crop insurance. The put options is another tool which we are really going all out to familiarize a lot of FPOs with. And we believe that this is a new era of risk management for farmers. So they do their marketing right when they're doing planting, not when they bring the crops to harvest.
So, you know, since we are talking about reforms and policy issues, let's also talk about what the government did. They did pass three very strong farm bills recently. And while, of course, there have been for it and against it, not so for it, but how do you as an exchange look at this? What initiatives do you think exchange can really bring out of this?
Yeah, I think it's brilliant. I mean, if you take MP as an example, just the removal of barriers. We used to have Anugya Patra, which means if you wanted to move your own produce stored from one mandi jurisdiction to another, it would involve a lot of paperwork. So I think this whole concept of a national market, which is true for every other good or service that we are currently seeing. Bank transfers have become so easy to do, but somehow purchase of agri products has remained almost prehistoric in terms of all these procedures and taxes. Even octroi was subsumed within GST, but mandi tax remained out of it. So I think this, at least the freedom for farmers and traders to link with each other on a national market is game changing. And I think we are going to see the benefits of it. There may be pockets of resistance, but I think as benefits flow, everyone will move towards competitive markets. And people who provide services can charge a fee. I think as an exchange, we charge a fee on the derivative markets. I'm sure as national spot markets build up, you have even corporates running their own electronic markets. So it's really good. It is, I think, like the UPI, as long as you have all these markets talk to each other, it will really bring about huge efficiency. I think it'll help everyone in the value chain.
Well, yes, the markets are opening up, but it's far from a perfect market that many of us desire here. Mr. Chaturvedi, let me come to you. How do you see the edible oil scenario as we move forward? We did speak about a bit in demand and supply, but I really want you to elaborate on this, because a lot of changes have been coming in the Indian markets globally as well, and edible oil clearly is a global commodity there. How do you look at the next year now? What are we learning from this year? What would your 360 degrees be on this?
Well, before I come on to the next year or how we see markets panning out, let me comment on one thing which probably we missed out. In fact, in the farm reforms, the biggest reform which actually has attracted me and is the Essential Commodities Act. And that Essential Commodities Act, the amount of damage it has done to the supply chain in this country, not many would probably recognize it. The kind of power the food inspector has, he can summon the managing director of the company under criminal charges for having one bag of XYZ commodity more. So I think that was one act which was doing more harm than it was helping. And in fact, I'm a bit surprised that I find a lot of farmers actually rooting for ECA, which is actually against them. If somebody buys their product, buys their commodity and stores it, it helps in the price moving up. And contrary to that, the farmers, I don't see any reason why they should be the ones opposing it. They should be the ones actually supporting it. So it's good that it has been buried, and I hope it is not brought above the ground.
Well, we've seen that being invoked already a couple of times. And I think farmers, what they don't like really is the MSP. That is what they wanted in the legislation. Yes, so how are you looking at that in totality then?
Now, as far as the edible oil scenario panning out is concerned, we are looking at a reasonably good mustard crop. Hopefully, the weather will hold. We've had reasonably good subsoil moisture because of the late rains. So, mustard crop, I would not be too surprised if it is in excess of about 10 million tons or thereabouts. But it's a little too early to start speculating on the mustard crop. But one thing what we are seeing is that the demand contraction is actually happening, whether people are realizing it or not. We are realizing it because we are in the consumer space. What we are seeing is, on a very rough basis, HoReCa segment, as far as palm is concerned, contributes about 33%. Then the bakery, vanaspati, in the domestic, direct to home, all that is at the range of about 18%. And the non-food sector contributes about 13%. So this HoReCa segment is the one which is affected big time. So we should not be too surprised if we see a little bit of a demand contraction happening going forward as well. India's consumption is pegged at around 23 million tons, give or take half a million ton here or there. This was till last year before last. But last year, what we are seeing is that our demand has collapsed to roughly about 21 million tons. Out of that 21 million tons, about 7.5 to 8 million tons is domestic sources, and about 13 million tons is imported. Now, going forward, if we have a much bigger crop of whether it's rapeseed or whether it's the next year's soya or groundnut or any other crop, so that much oil would be surplus in the system, and with demand also contracting by about almost 1.5 to 2%. In fact, you must realize that it was actually going up by about 3 to 4% in the last decade or so. So, which means it's a double whammy, in the sense that you could possibly be seeing a contraction of about 5% or thereabouts. So that could possibly make markets a lot more sober than what they have been. But having said this, we still are faced with the La Nina prospects, with Latin American crop numbers and the planting intention, planting not keeping pace. Brazil is lagging behind a bit compared to last year. Argentina is lagging behind. And people are saying that Malaysia and Indonesia could possibly be suffering because of too much of rains. Southern hemisphere in La Nina gets less rains, and the northern hemisphere gets more rains. So a lot is going to depend on weather, as quite a few of your other panelists also said. We'll have to really wait and watch. But having said this, I think we have reached practically the biting point as far as the prices in the domestic market is concerned. So now you find palm oil selling almost like 100 rupees a kilo and thereabout. So this is kind of a biting point. And the other thing is that we feel that post Diwali, the crushing operations as far as soya is concerned would probably really pick up big time. And that could also add to the sobriety or the sobering of the prices. But the fact remains that the weather is going to be playing front. Coming to the next year's projection, my take is that our imports might fall by about 500,000 tons. So sunflower oil, which we imported about 2.5 million tons, might actually go below 2 million tons. I won't be too surprised in that, because Black Sea area has suffered. Palm oil could be around in the same region as about 7 million tons. Soya oil, anything between 3 to 3.5. So overall, we could possibly have something like 12.5 to 13 million tons of imports. So the government of India can actually breathe a sigh of relief.
Okay, I'm sure. I mean, those are a lot of numbers and very relevant numbers, all of that. And what hits me the most, Mr. Chaturvedi, is clearly the consumption number, where you've said that we are looking at a degrowth actually in this year and perhaps the next as well. Neerav, that's about the Indian numbers that Mr. Chaturvedi put out. How are you looking at the international numbers now? We've seen with Biden coming in, most of the investors believe that the US and China trade tensions perhaps may ease out as well. But China continues to be one of the major buyers, importers too. How are you looking at the international cues, and how are you looking at that impacting the fundamentals?
So before going on that, adding up to something that Vipinji said, so basically, when we are talking about risk management today, this year, the highest return came from VIX, one of the highest returns. So VIX is the volatility index. So this has been the high, I would say, one of the most volatile year that we have seen from January last year. When we start, like this year, we started January, we were on the peak of the markets. The palm oil was at 3,200 ringgit. Even the Indian markets were at its peak. And then the corona news started pouring into the market. By February, we started melting. By March, we were already on the ground. By April, we were digging inside. So market fell like this. And then again, we saw the market rallying. After April, we saw a lot of supply disruptions everywhere in the consuming countries as well as the producing countries. There were a lot of supply hiccups. So we again see the market going up. By this time, we are already back. So this was like a V recovery in the market. So I think market has been very volatile, and the volatility in coming times is going to be there. And so I think hedging is one thing that is quintessential in our markets. And prima facie, if we talk about commodity trading, commodity processing, everything is like an arbitrage. What is the arbitrage? It's between the origination to destination market. We have to do an arbitrage. We have to buy and simultaneously trade or sell into the destination market with some small profit. Or if we are procuring some raw material and we are selling some finished product, we are doing an arbitrage. We are procuring at X price and at simultaneously at the same time we are trying to sell. So if we are not able to procure or if we are not able to sell, the exchanges are where we have to come and hedge the risk. And I think that is very important to keep a healthy organization, especially to all our Indian companies which are growing. I see a big hurdle for all the Indian people or the Indian owned companies. If they do not practice proper risk management, they put the company at a big risk. So that's one important thing that I wanted to say. And now going back onto the international market front, yeah, I think Biden coming in, people in China a little relaxed. We feel it's going to be a little friendlier to the market, though China seemed to be covering quite a bit before the US election. The market was rallying. Even after the news came in, market rallied. So maybe market could be slightly toppish at the nearby zone, but market is very well supported. Even Biden is supposed to be more friendly to the biofuel policy. Trump was supposed to be supporting more of the crude oil sellers. So I think that is also helping in. World might come out of, or may be habituated to the corona. And in coming quarters, we will see things getting more normal. So all that things are going to keep the Western world and China a little upbeat. But yes, the prices have rallied too fast and too high. And we will have to see, healthy corrections will come in. And yes, India will see a contraction in demand, or we are already seeing resistance from the consumer because we were in 3-digit in soybean oil. And just 3 days back, we went into 4-digit at 1,000 rupees. So that's a remarkable level, and that is going to hit the consumer. And there would be I would say demand side, there would be a little bit of issues. But I think quarter one of next year or the nearby seem to be tight. We don't see a lot of supply coming in from other areas. So corrections might come into the market. And then again, markets might be supported.
Mr. Vijay Kumar, everybody seems to be saying that this has been a very difficult year in sense of prices, in sense of crop, and there was just too many fundamentals to deal with. How has the year been for the exchange? I mean, you have started new initiatives here. This clearly has been the year for agriculture in various ways of the kind of reform that we see coming from the government as well. So what is the road ahead from the exchanges side when it comes to agri and especially edible oil?
Yeah, I think it's certainly been very good. I would say, for example, in soybean, we've seen open interest move from about 80,000 tons to about over 2 lakh tons now. But considering that the crop is 10 million tons, we should see a lot more. And that gives us a cause for concern in the sense that people are still possibly exposing themselves. And this is, as I said, right from farmers who are seeing good prices and still possibly not yet locking it in. And we wonder why. And maybe the reason is everyone expects maybe even higher prices. But this is the sort of thing that needs to change. So for a 10 million ton crop, we should at least see a million, 2 million tons being hedged. And I think that is what most mature markets see. And we are certainly communicating actively as was pointed out. I think it's important for banks to also to convey this. We have seen, Mr. Chaturvedi is here, but we have a few prominent oilseed crush plants missing in the Indian landscape. And unfortunately, as Vipin put it, if you want to be in this business for 100 years as a company, you should bring in very prudent risk management practices. So, and this is true irrespective whether it's a government entity or a private sector entity or farmers. We are working with government agencies also, encouraging them to hedge their exposures and to use these markets in a manner that everyone benefits. While the farmer gets a good price, everyone benefits by de-risking themselves and serving the role that they play. So a wholesaler, for instance, is making his 1 or 1.5% margin by being a wholesaler. A processor is earning his maybe 1-2% margin and maybe more if he's got a brand. But that's it. No one's trying to make 20% and 30% by sitting on open exposures. I think that's the critical thing. So as we go forward, prudent risk management practices being adopted by farmers, using put options, for instance, and by trade and industry, will certainly bring regular, not high margins, but regular profitability to everyone in the value chain. So I would certainly, as of course, being in NCDEX, we've always wanted this, and we see very good examples of corporates who have such practices. But I think now we are expanding the scope, and we really want to handhold multiple players, especially farmers, to use the markets more actively.
Well, yes, that is the need of the hour, especially when everybody seems to be saying that there are just too many fundamentals, a lot of uncertainty, and there are concerns going forward, especially when it comes to consumption. So yes, hedging perhaps seems to be the valid way of doing that. Vipin, what would you say is the worst behind us? I mean, as you said, in many, many years, this one has been the most uncertain of that. Are you now in the game? Would you say that the worst is behind us and you are looking at more certain fundamentals in front of you?
I won't say worst is behind us, though I hope I can say that. But looking at the weather, I think we are still far away from anything getting stable into a stable zone. So there are a lot of uncertainties still left. Overall balance sheet looks really, really tight. We saw some correction last week. I think that was more because of COVID concerns in Europe. But I think now everybody understands COVID restrictions may not be in line with what we see in phase one. But fundamentally, especially for soft oil, balance sheet is very, very tight. You talk about sunflower, you talk about soybean oil in South America. Not many times we see US supplying soybean oil to India. I think this we are seeing after 6 or 7 years, which itself says market is very, very tight in South America. And if COVID situation worsens, we have seen household demand for soft oil actually goes up instead of going down. So yes, we have seen a fair bit of rally. I agree with Nirav that market can correct or should correct, but fundamentally I still see a lot of room for market to rally. That's reflecting the tighter balance sheet.
So this is out of course, but I do want to ask this, Vipin, and you know, with the kind of health fads, and we recently do know that the one of the Indian ministers did say that Indians weren't eating enough sugar. How is the edible oil consumption, especially when we are looking at a degrowth? Are Indians also choosing their edible oils properly? Are you looking at a decline in consumption? One, because of this reason as well?
To be fair, I think we have seen decline in consumption at the upper class, upper echelons, but I don't think that's what bringing our overall consumption down. I think it's more of core situation, ability for consumers to buy, and the demand destruction due to prices. Because if you see fall in prices, it's mainly related to palm and not to other soft oils. Whereas health fat would be more in consumers who are on soft oils. At least that's the way I see it. But yes, there is a demand destruction, but I don't think it's for health fat. There'll be a very small percentage, but this demand destruction is certainly not.
No, I was just trying it out. If that was one of the reasons to look at, tell me about the investment opportunities in the sector. Like from where we stand right now, with all the fundamentals now put in. Actually, let me come to each one of you and get to know on what is that one thing that you would want to watch out for from here on when you look at the agri sector and especially the edible oil space. What is that traders, the farmers, the corporates should watch out for from here on? It has been an uncertain year, yes, from presidential elections to weather to COVID impact, etc. And we are still not out of the woods here. But Neerav, let me start with you. How do you, what opportunities do you look at this in sector?
So, first thing I would look at is a good correction in the market to buy something. So, because the S&Ps are tight, and as I mentioned, nearby to first quarter is quite a bit tight. Second is I would like to watch on the US dollar. How does the US dollar perform? A lot of perception is going on in the market, in the grapevine, that the dollar might weaken. If that happens, then the commodities may further rally. So that is the second thing I would like to watch. I would like to see how does China now do, because China was quite aggressive before the election. Now after this thing happening, how is their buying there continuing? How are they, or are they quite long and they are doing some profit taking? Because good thing about China is that they also look at the value of the commodity. So it's not that they just be gung-ho at all prices. So at lower prices, maybe we feel that China is too aggressive in buying, but it's more like a price-driven buying. Maybe at higher prices, they might slow down. So that could be a situation. But I think hands in the destination might change from China, India, to the other parts of the world. Origins are tight. So they might, if one destination slows down, the other destination might come in. So origins might not loosen up a lot. But yes, I think this is where we have to find the gaps to trade into this market and look into how does the market fare up. I think also important for us would be to see, does India have a big second wave? Because what we are seeing in tier two city in the rural market, people are back in the markets, at least for Diwali shopping. People are not going to the restaurants and not going to too much weddings, and all those things are not happening, but at least people are back into the market to purchase. So do we see a bad second wave coming in? So I think we'll have to see when does the vaccine come. So how much now COVID impacts our demand overall. So that's another factor that we would like to see on the markets.
Yeah. All right. I don't know, Neerav, if you did realize or not, but every time when you were talking, I was just quickly jotting down those points, and you've named all the C's: China, crop, climate, COVID, catering. So yes, there is, you mentioned at least 5 points on what to look forward to in the days to come. Mr. Chaturvedi, what are you looking at? What would you want to watch? And what would you actually see in the edible oil sector? What does it really need right now?
Well, let me share with you a colleague of mine from Wilmar. He used to say that fundamentals only contribute about 30 to 35% in the price discovery. Balance 60 to 70% is actually decided by youngsters sitting behind the computer and moving billions of dollars from one commodity to another. So that is possibly one area. And what we are seeing is too much of free money at money. Practically zero interest rate floating around in the world. So you have companies not doing well, but stock market going through the roof. You have demand contracting and demand destruction happening worldwide, but commodity market moving up. So this kind of a scenario, how long is going to last is something which we will have to watch. whether Biden's policy are also free money, which it is likely to be. And if that be the case, easy liquidity in the system is bound to put inflationary pressure as far as the commodities are concerned. What we will be looking at seriously is the fiscal supports which the governments are going to give worldwide. India is no different. Chinese demand, China is probably one country which seems to be doing exceedingly well. And I'm friends of ours keep telling us that restaurants and all are in China are all open and it's, life is absolutely normal. So Chinese demand could be reasonably strong and their hog population has ballooned like nobody's business. Then we will also have to see how the COVID pans out in Malaysia and Indonesia, because what we are seeing is a lot of the labor had run away. So in spite of the fact that you have a very good crop, but the mills are not running because the FFBs are not being taken out. So that we'll have to see how they react and how they handle that situation. As far as the planting delays are concerned, I think we've already factored all those things in the pricing. And Brazil is probably now inching back to the same level as what it was last year. So overall, these are some areas, and we will also be watching how India opens up. And as Nirav rightly said, whether we are going to have a second wave or one wave is enough to give us nightmares. So that is something which we will have to keep watching. Another second wave would mean more demand destruction. These are some of the areas which we'll have to probably seriously evaluate and how the mustard crop sowing actually takes place, yeah, and how it pans out. Because that is going to have a big impact. Mustard will come in March or April, March, but its reaction would start coming earlier because the market starts reacting much faster than the actual event. So we'll have to probably look at that.
Market is the most emotional of us all. That is the reason we keep calling it sentiment moving there.
And one more thing which I wanted to add to the hedging thing. Generally, what happens is most of the hedgers, they try and make money both from the long side as well as on the physically long and long the exchange as well, which effectively means it's not a hedge. And it should not be treated as an instrument of making additional money. So, and this is where people tend to go wrong. And that is the reason why we've seen a lot of firms going belly up as far as Castor is concerned. You had people going long physical, and you also had people going long on the exchange. So you are doubling your position and not hedging. So that is something which one needs to be on guard.
Oh, absolutely. Ms. Chaturvedi, actually, I have a question coming in from you. This is from Sujatra Haldar, who wants to know, what is your take on the rice bran oil import from Bangladesh?
Aha. That's a tough one. In fact, this, the kind of support which India has been giving to the neighboring countries of zero duty, that is something which is not helping our industry, especially in the eastern part. We had managed to get the palm oil off the list. Now, if rice bran is coming or soybean is coming, we'll probably have to look at that as well. Because with our duties being in the region of about 40-45%, and duty and goods coming in from Bangladesh or Sri Lanka or Nepal at practically zero duty, so Indian processors just cannot compete. So that is something which we'll seriously look at if rice bran is coming in a big way.
Well, yes, there are those things, and the government policies is something that we, of course, have been talking about for some time, especially when the prices were rising and the festive demand as well was slightly on the higher side. But coming to you, Vipin, how are you looking at opportunity into this sector now? Edible oil space, we have spoken on various myths and, on the hedging itself, on encouraging people and ensuring that they hedge rightly. That's really another thing. But how are you looking at the sector going forward?
Before replying to that, I would just like to thank Satul for clarifying what is hedging and what it is not. I think that's very important, and he's right. Quite a time, people get carried away and use exchange to develop their positions rather than hedging it. So very valid point, sir. That's where experience comes. Coming at the investment opportunity, I sincerely believe for supporting Atmanirbhar Bharat, this is the year when you will have a lot of mustard crop. You had good soybean crop curtailed by weather. If weather goes good for mustard, you will have a bumper mustard crop. And it's up to the government to ensure that we don't sort of take an action which destroys the mustard price from where it is right now. We need to maintain that price, show it to farmer, and not at the time of sowing only. We need to ensure that he gets that price when he's actually harvesting. There is no hedge for... we have seen from the open interest that farmers are not really hedging on to NCDX. So, to me, lowering duty would send a very wrong signal to the mustard farmers, to the soybean farmers. And if we stand behind them as a government, as an industry, then we'll see this production going up, and you will see a lot of people actually putting up industry, because right now you can put up industry, but you're not assured of the raw material. So especially after all the amendments that government has done, I think it's a time where investment will come, provided we back it up with the right policies. We have done some good amendments, but yes, we should not fall back to what we have done with onion. We should not do that in other sectors, because it damages the confidence of the investing community. But if government stand behind those amendments, I think it's a very good opportunity for more investment to flow in. And not only on imported oil, but more so on domestic sector as well.
Mr. Vijay Kumar, I mean, you heard the conversation, and as Mr. Chaturvedi said, as Vijay also said, that hedging one and hedging correctly is the second thing. And the third thing that I want to have you answer as a question is that we've been talking about mustard and how we've seen very good prices this time is the reason farmers have gone and sown it. But next year and the next crop when it comes in would be high and the prices might come down. So this is the time that FPOs make use of the, you know, strategy and initiative that the exchange has come up with. So how are you ensuring that that happens? I'm sure the industry as well needs to start talking. The stakeholders need to come on to this one. But when we know that the prices may move in a certain direction, how are you encouraging, ensuring that stakeholders do come in for this?
Yeah, I think one thing for industry definitely is while we all want the mustard crop to grow, to increase, I think it's the industry that should step up and give that price signal in March, April. It's not as if we tell farmers to grow more, and farmers may grow more, but we are at least encouraging farmers through FPOs to plant and sell at the same time. And whether you sell on futures or you buy a put option, I think this is on the other side of it is those who are writing options or buying futures. And those are processors or traders who are who want to be long because they have some demand for the domestic markets. And I think this price signaling mechanism industry has to do directly with farmers, especially now that we have this import structure. It should not happen that we have farmers growing a lot and then prices crashing. So this price signaling mechanism needs industry to step up there and to then downstream start selling the cake and the oil as well. And I think even in maize, for instance, where we have a 20 million ton crop, it seems almost that industry is taking a hands-off position. If you want farmers to grow it, you have to signal it, and you cannot operate on a basis that if the crop is high here, we will get low prices, and if unfortunately the crop is low here, we'll demand imports. I think this is the problem that maybe industry can solve itself by not having different lobbies sort of aim at low import duty suddenly or high import duty suddenly. Instead, to give a steady price signal to the farmers so that the crop that you want is grown by the farmer profitably. And then, of course, there are other people who can take risks and hedge their risks and processors. But definitely, at least for farmers and FPOs, one needs to have processors stand there and give the right signals for March, April, for rapeseed as well. And for FPOs, of course, to take advantage of that rather than and hedge themselves rather than take a risk, which is really not necessary. They are already taking risks of various crop-related risks, but as far as price is concerned, it can be locked through market-related instruments. So I think it'll be really good in the oilseed sector if industry, trade, and farmers adopt market-linked instruments rather than keep signaling to the government and demanding A from the government or B from the government. It'll really be good because here there is a deficit, and both farmers and processors can fill in that gap in a mutually compatible manner.
Well, that is very well said. Yes, if you have market-linked instruments, make use of that instead of going to government and asking it at all times, because those are, let me not call it interference, but every time the government comes in, taking those steps back also becomes like a challenge there. So I think I have all my questions answered here. So there is going to be crop and weather and demand and various other factors in the international markets which will impact the crop and the prices and the demand going forward. And then, as Mr. Trivedi very rightly said, much of that move also comes in from various trigger pushing, trigger happy people as well, which actually move the prices quite a lot, as we've seen in various other asset classes, including edible oil prices as well. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining today and giving that 360-degree perspective on what the edible oil sector is looking like, right from the farmers to FPOs to hedging to crop and demand, etc. I have perhaps a couple of minutes more to spend here. If there is a final word of advice that you would want to give out to the edible oil sector as a whole, what would that really be? Mr. Chaturvedi, let's start with you on that.
Stay invested. India is shining and Indian oilseed crop is going to grow because now we are moving towards Atmanirbharta. And my only advice or request to the government is don't tinker with the duties. Because if you tinker with the duties and start pampering the urban consumer at the cost of the rural oilseed farmer, you will be sending a wrong signal. And this is what Vipin also said. And I would like to reiterate that the government should keep away from tinkering with the duties. It is high time that they did a pulses as far as oilseed is concerned. Pulses is one example where they have done wonderfully well in terms of policy. And I think it needs to be replicated as far as oilseed is concerned. Because 70% demand being met by imports, you've already sacrificed your edible oil security big time. It's high time that you probably will retrieve it to the extent possible.
Oh, well, absolutely. And for that, the industry really needs to come together, stand together and make those mature choices there. Vipin, you're next. What is your one line of advice?
Yeah, I think I would say, just as the Prime Minister has been telling us on an individual level, how to be safe from COVID situation, I would say same advice to the company, how to be safe with COVID or without COVID. Just keep on hedging your all the risk and maintain social distancing from punting. I think that's what enables you companies to survive and prosper.
Vipin, a company like yours, how is it looking at the sector? I mean, are you investing? Are you still bullish on this whole consumption story?
Obviously, the way Indian population is there, we have a bad year this year. We might have a bad year next year. I think long-term growth story is still there. You have to stay invested. And to me, the more domestic crop we see, it will make the entire ecosystem far more sustainable. So we have to support that. And we are committed to the long-term story for sure.
Neera, what is your sense? Where do you see the most value being generated here?
So basically, I feel India is going to be a prominent player in the edible oil, and not just edible oil, but even in the oilseed sector. We see even the meal demand growing internally, and we're going to have a robust demand here. Similarly, what Atulji said, we need to have a robust production also domestically. And it's been long that we are depending on import. There are lot of hinterland crush plants, processing plants, which are already there. And I think people have kind of figured out how to work with that. So overall, India seems to be very promising place for oil and oilseed sector. But a very, very important thing for all the Indian owned companies is you have to understand the risk you are carrying on the business. And if that is not mitigated well, may that be commodity price risk, hedging on NCDX, or maybe that's currency price risk. Everything has to be properly vetted, because volatility is going to be there. It's not going to go down. It's going to be there. And black swan events like COVID, which no one of us had thought of, happened. So that's very important.
Oh, well, yeah, absolutely. So life can bring you challenges and opportunities as well. So hedging is one thing that you should perhaps, make part of as a regular practice in your daily life. So, you are all top of your game here, and I've been talking to you for so many years, and you're more friends now than industry experts. And thank you so much for taking time out today and talking all of that about the edible oil sector. But before we wind up, Mr. Vijay Kumar, final words from you.
Yeah, it's been a wonderful discussion ahead of Diwali. So it's I think the same sort of advice that we give people on Diwali with fireworks is stay safe. With COVID, it's been stay safe. So I think even here, I would strongly encourage people to that and state that hope is not a strategy. Don't assume tomorrow will give you a better price. Stay hedged, stay safe, and sleep well. So with that, I think it's going to be a very good season and a very good long innings for the oil seeds and oil sector. I think India will definitely be Atmanirbhar in the long term if we do all the right short-term steps, as the panelists have pointed out.
All right. But that's cheers to the edible oil sector. Gentlemen, yet again, thank you so much for talking, sharing all of that knowledge and opportunities that the sector has with us. Thank you so much, participants, as well. So for being there and listening to this conversation and posting your feedback and questions as well. But with that, we'll wrap up this discussion. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.